I want to thank you very much, the organizers who invited me to say happy birthday to George and to wish him another 60 years of very helpful, very, very fruitful research. Okay, I will be talking about Lp Baum-Connes conjecture, and the conjecture actually, there will be some words explaining what the conjecture is, but essentially I suppose that most of you know what the Baum-Connes conjecture is about. Now, why Lp? That's the main subject. Because essentially, in his work on the conjecture, Vincent Lafforgue actually used Banach algebra techniques, and he used Lp spaces, etc. So it was one of the reasons why it's necessary, and it's I will explain why it's useful to look at the analog of Baum-Connes conjecture for Lp version of it. And also there is another reason which I'll explain later, because it's the reason is there are examples where the main result is applied, which I will explain. So let me tell you what I mean by Lp Baum-Connes conjecture. First of all, one can complete the algebra L1 of G, convolution algebra, not only as an algebra of operators on L2 of G, but also on, as an algebra of operators on all the scale of Lp of G. P varies actually from 1 to infinity, without actually, I will use maybe 1, but not infinity. So the K-theory of this completed algebra will be the right side of Lp Baum-Connes conjecture. This is joint work with Guliang Yu. The main result is obtained in collaboration with Guliang Yu. Now, I will need a notion of an Lp algebra, which is a kind of stuff which starts to penetrate mathematics, and I've seen Guliang showed me recent work, recent articles by Chris Phillips, who specifically asked some questions about Lp algebras. It's in a sense that we started this thinking about Lp algebras maybe about 6-7 years ago with Guliang, so it was kind of parallel. So it seems useful to use algebras or operators on Lp spaces and subalgebras which are closed subalgebras. So a subalgebra called which is acts on Lp of Z is complete will be called Lp algebra. I can define the reduced or regular cross product of a group and an Lp algebra. And for this, I take the space Z where the algebra B acts, which is an algebra operator on Z, and consider this Lp of G cross Z. And the usual formula gives an action of this cross product algebra on this space, Lp of G cross Z. So the notation is well inspired by the usual notation, but the letter P is added here. This P means that it's really completion in the LP norm. Okay, now, again, in this special case, when B is just complex numbers, we get the algebra C star P reduced of G. The small remark is that when G is unimodular, the dual to the convolution by an element F in L1 of G is the convolution by F star of G. F star is the usual conjugate in the L1 of G. And for this reason, these two algebras of P with P and Q, Q is a dual number, as it was in the previous slide, they are isomorphic. And the remark is by interrelation theorem, since this algebra acts both on LP and LQ, it acts also on L2. So there is a natural homomorphism, which is quite useful. It's a good question whether this homomorphism is surjective on K-theory. And I'll explain why it is reasonable to ask this question for the Baum-Connes conjecture. To state the Baum-Connes conjecture in LP case, we need E theory for Banach algebras. The theory essentially was developed by my student Fan Fei Chong in his PhD, which he passed last year at Vanderbilt. So the definition essentially is the same, but techniques of Banach algebras is not quite. It's not quite sister algebra techniques. So there are some differences. In any case, one starts with asymptotic morphisms, and I assume that it should be more or less known to people what asymptotic morphism is. But there is a non-trivial point. First non-trivial point is the construction of asymptotic morphism using the Cohn-Hixon construction for an extension. For this, one needs certain assumption on the ideal. So this requires quasi-central approximate unit for the ideal. And this ideal should be an LP algebra. To construct the quasi-central approximate unit, we'll assume that this ideal has a countable bounded approximate unit, which satisfies certain additional assumption that if we denote the differences of elements by bi, then this norm is bounded uniformly, whatever sequence kj we take. Bounded approximate unit exists, for example, in the algebra of holomorphic functions, which will be used in this talk. Now, the proposition is that if J satisfies this property that there is an approximate unit like this and B mod J is separable, then there is a quasi-central bounded approximate unit with respect to B. And also with respect to G, if G acts by isometrically on B. Because we are interested mainly in E theory of LP algebras, we'll be using stabilization an ideal of compact operators on LP spaces. In general, there are no big difficulty. One just takes Blackadar's book, for example, or any other book on which contains E theory, but at least a couple of points require some techniques which use this special approximate units, etc. So it's not just you take full proofs for sister algebras and you translate word by word. It's not quite. So, but I cannot. I don't think I will have time to go into this technique. So at least the thesis is available on the internet. Okay. Now we need this descent homomorphism, which essentially is kind of similar, very similar stuff as in the approach of Günther Higgs and Trout. And because L1 algebra maps into this cross product algebra, we can also define this kind of descent homomorphism. Now, in the statement of the Baum-Connes conjecture, we use naturally the space classifying space for proper actions. The left-hand side is, as usual, same as in the case of sister algebras, but B is an Lp algebra here. The limit is taken over G proper, G compact, locally compact spaces. And I should mention that the left-hand side of Baum-Connes conjecture for Lp is for when B is just complex numbers, is exactly the same as Baum-Connes conjecture, usual Baum-Connes conjecture for L2. So the assembly map is defined as usual by using this cutoff function on the space X. If X is a locally compact space, G compact with proper action of G. So this is an idempotent element in this algebra, and certainly also in L1 as well. Now the map itself is defined as follows. We take any element in this group, apply this homomorphism, get an element in this group where the first argument is L1, and then we take the intersection product, E theory product, with this idempotent element which sits in L1. And the Baum-Connes conjecture is that the statement that this map is bijective, both surjective and injective. So the remark is that when B is complex numbers, it appears that because the left-hand side is just the usual Baum-Connes conjecture, and there is a the definition of the assembly map is exactly the same. The Baum-Connes conjecture for L2 factors through this map. In particular, if this map is not surjective, then Baum-Connes conjecture is not true. That's. I will continue about this remark a little later also. Now, this is a kind of speculative slide. I just want. It's a little fantasy. I can say that. In the world of Baum-Connes conjecture, there are people working on it who are real kind of faithful devotees, like Paul, for example, one of the founders. And there are people who are a little bit already fatigated, and I talked with Vincent, and a couple of times he said to me that he left for Langlands because he's blocked with Baum-Connes. So that's, and there are some people still who are interested and continue. So for those people, what I can imagine a reasonable thing is that one should think about counterexample. Of course, if Paul were here, I wouldn't dare just to mention even this. But I will mention because let's say that how can one detect that this map on the previous slide, this map is not surjective. To detect this, maybe one can try to reformulate the RD property, to adapt it to LP case. If one can adapt in such a way that there is a group which, for LP case, satisfies this RD property and doesn't satisfy RD property for L2, this particular group may be very interesting to examine about concerning the surjectivity of this this map, this previous map. Why I think so is because it looks like, well, at least from Vincent's thesis, PhD, it's more or less clear that there is a large, huge class of groups which satisfy the so-called Bose conjecture, and it means that this K-theory is isomorphic to left-hand side of the Baum-Connes. And from 1, Q equal to 1 to Q equal to 2, there may be some jumps in the K-theory of LP completion. And so to detect these jumps, one has to choose carefully P and certainly find the group. That's but this is kind of a reasonable suggestion from, well, a little fantasy. But anyway, it's something one can think about. Okay, now the main result of our work with Guliang, and what we did is based on, essentially, is inspired by his theorem that any hyperbolic group acts properly isometrically on some LP space in a certain way which is described here. So there is a countable set, countable discrete set, actually it's G cross G, G is a discrete hyperbolic group. The action is such that the action actually, the linear part of the action is just induced by the action on Z itself. And that, in these assumptions, we just tried and I think succeeded to generalize this to LP case. My joint work with Nigel, where the group acts on a Hilbert space. And it's interesting that the techniques, well, appropriately modified, does work and gives the result without, I know, we haven't yet written the text, but I hope it will be much, much shorter than Vincent's work on hyperbolic groups with coefficients. So this is kind of more conventional thing to obtain Lp Baum-Connes conjecture for hyperbolic groups. But of course, P depends on the hyperbolic group. That's a certain disadvantage. It's not, yeah. Z is G mod G, G times G.
No, no, I understand, but what I'm saying is that I presume that the Banach space and P of Z remembers something about the set Z.
Yeah. You mean whether it's discrete or whether it's...
it's discrete, how much does it remember about the space?
Yeah, well, but if we talk about compact operators, they are compact operators on LP of discrete atomic... Ah, yes, well, this I don't know how important it is. It is used in the proof because it simplifies quite a bit the techniques. But of course, on the Hilbert space, there is no difference. But on a Banach space, many things matter, and it might be that it's not really important at all. But so far, what I present is what we can do just by bare hands, no? Because it's the technique is completely different from the Hilbert space. It's kind of so we adapt what we can, but okay. So I will sketch a little bit this argument. So my work with Nigel contained the construction of a certain extension of sister algebras, which allows to construct two asymptotic morphisms. First of all, the algebra which is associated with the Banach space, and then of course this S will be also a little bit different, but it will have the same K here, C0 var. This will be the Bott asymptotic morphism, and also there will be a Dirac asymptotic morphism, which comes from the extension. At this point, I assume a little bit at least some people read our paper with Nigel, but essentially all steps will be indicated in my talk. So to make this whole scheme work, what we do, we start with the Banach space, which is Lp space, inductive limit. And the inductive limit is constructed again. We choose a certain vacuum vector associated with Lp, so that there will be some p in the all kind of formulas for finite dimensional space. For Lp on a finite dimensional space, we choose this function, so our Z will be just a discrete space, and we exhaust it by finite subspaces. And also we need this alpha, which is a parameter for the field of Banach spaces. So far this is parallel to the Hilbert space case. Now we use this inductive procedure to construct the inductive limit. We normalize this function to norm one, Lp norm one, and define this Banach spaces and inductive limit of this Lp by just embedding any vector to a vector tensor of this psi, any vector psi into psi tensor this normalized vector. To do the parallel construction to the Hilbert space case, we need the Bott Dirac operator, which is a kind of harmonic oscillator operator, combination of Bott and Dirac. And this is defined by the more or less usual formulas, but again, in this case, quantities depending on p enter. Essentially, it's a the both Dirac operator is the sum of two operators, which one of them is related with the exterior product, another with the interior product. Ek are basis vectors which are fixed, corresponding to the delta functions on the initial space Z. Important remark is that T square actually can be presented as a sum of operators which all commute with each other. So that's a useful thing, because essentially int x and x int they annihilate, and different coordinates they commute. Now, what we need actually to renormalize this operator, because in L2 case there was no need to renormalize, but here you may know that this beta is actually zero in the situation when p and q are equal to 2. But in the Lp case, we need this renormalization. And the operator which is a Dirac operator which is contracted using some increasing sequence of coefficients lambda will be the sum of renormalized coordinate-wise operators. Now, when alpha varies, we get a continuous field of Lp Banach algebras, these compact operator algebras, and the both Dirac operators as unbounded multipliers. When alpha goes to zero, we will obtain in the limit a certain algebra which I'll define. It will be next in my talk. So this should give the Bott element, the limit of these operators should give the Bott element for this algebra. Now, of course, the construction of a field for all alpha is related with the existence of this based on the cross product algebra construction, where alpha is just the speed of the action of R on this R. And when alpha goes to zero, these lambda k's are chosen so that they go to one. So they, in the Bott case, they disappear. There will be no coefficient lambda k, and also no alpha, because alpha goes to zero. Now, what remains in the Bott case will be essentially the derivative is replaced by the symbol. And this function of x, it remains. This term remains. So we will get similar construction. We'll use inductive limit again. The whole Bott element is BK will be the sum of two parts again. Star doesn't mean really that you have star, because the star should be understood in the sense of adapted to LP case essentially. So the Bott operator will be a multiplication operator, but it also contains exterior and interior product, which was in the Bott Dirac. So this Bott element constructed here requires renormalization again with the same power of B square for any finite subset. Now, to define this algebra formally, we start with the algebra of holomorphic functions. Actually, for A of X, we could use, this is a remark which will appear on some slide later, that one can define this algebra A of X using either holomorphic functions, algebra, or an algebra of continuous functions on a half plane. Well, essentially on a half plane, half complex plane. And this half plane, real part positive. But the algebra is required to have its functions vanishing at infinity. Say if it is a positive half plane, it's functions vanishing at infinity in the usual sense. If to define it completely rigorously, one just takes conformal map into D2 and requires that these are all functions which vanish at one point minus one. So the norm will be the sup norm, and it's clear that the function in this holomorphic function in this half plane will vanish as a certain power of z. But as I say, there is a modification of this which will be useful in the argument, in the proof, that one can take not only holomorphic functions but just continuous functions and still have the same good property, except that one needs this decrease at infinity. Now, we'll use the cone like this. So we use this cone as the to introduce the algebra of functions. This cone C1/2 and the algebra S will be consist of all holomorphic or actually continuous functions where F1 and F0 belong to this H plus as I defined before. So it's like even and odd part in the usual setting for the Hilbert space. So they multiply in such a way that this epsilon square is one, because we take epsilon in the first Clifford algebra. Now z is in C plus, so z square z is z square is in C plus, so these functions are well defined because the arguments are where they should be, and the norm. We chose the cube of z. Well, about this, there may be some. We are still in a certain discussion. But at least this works. Maybe it's not necessary to take the cube, but in any case, it works so far. So this is a graded algebra, and the grading is induced by grading of first Clifford algebra. It's important just that this algebra has the same criteria C0 var. It's simply you use the six term exact sequence, you remove this point, you use the fact that these parts are both two parts are contractible algebras, so you get a certain exact sequence which gives you the K theory of C0 var. It's similar to, if you take a projection on the real line, you'll get a similar thing as for the real line. You can prove that that's an isomorphism in K theory. Okay, we use to construct A of X, we use the inductive system, the same inductive system as in the construction of the Banach space. But it's important that we need to use only those affine subspaces whose underlying vector space is a coordinate subspace of X. Well, this is again a kind of technical thing which we need, but it simplifies life, and we don't take all affine subspaces anyway. So the difference of two affine subspaces will be a coordinate subspace of the Lp of Z. Now, this algebra is inductive limit in the usual sense that we take these algebras, embed them by using this formula where F is understood as F is defined. F is defined as the sum of the two things. Here, N is the sum of normalization operators, which, by the way, this power Q over two is important. It's it's pretty similar to what you get in the Hilbert space case. Essentially, it's yeah. Sorry, I don't hear you. Well, it's all products are LP products. All LP, yeah. It's not because we cannot mix up things. All products are LP products. So the group acts using the linear action is diagonal, and one cocycle acts on the real part of X tends C. So gamma acts on the algebra A of X. Again, you can say that there is a certain kind of properness, symmetric properness, etc. So there is properness in the sense. Similar sense to the usual C star case. And the Bott map actually is naturally comes from the inductive limit construction. So here is a remark which I mentioned before, that you can replace holomorphic functions in the definition by continuous functions, and this will be quite useful. Now, the Dirac asymptotic morphism comes from the extension using the conjecture construction. I will not go into much detail in construction of extension, except that I will give some precise formula how to construct the function f for this f when f is holomorphic. That's important, that for Dirac operator you cannot use continuous functions. You have to use homomorphic functions. That's where the two things are work kind of coherently. One needs holomorphic functions for holomorphic functional calculus. We define f of d square using this integral. It is well defined if the path is in C plus kind of this path should be this path gamma should be maybe in other direction, probably it's a positive direction like this. So the path gamma should be carefully chosen close to the imaginary axis. And why? Because the operator d square, what is it? So the operator d square generates a holomorphic semigroup. That's an important thing to note. It means that there is an estimate for z minus d square inverse, which contains the z in denominator. And this is true only in a certain sector. So in a certain sector like this. So there is a certain sector, this bigger sector, where the sector where the estimate is out exactly outside this sector determined by a certain angle here. So this means that one can using also the fact that f of z vanishes at infinity by definition of the algebra S. So we have at least square of z in this integral when we take an estimate in norm. So when we estimate, there is a convergence at infinity because of this assumption on f. I will not go into detail about the further detail about the construction of this extension. So that essentially all I can say about this thing. And the Dirac asymptotic morphism comes exactly from this extension using the Cohn-Hixon construction. How does the proof of the conjecture? I'm sorry, this is not well centered, but that's all I could could arrange using my knowledge of tech. So the one uses the same diagram as usual. This diagram is well known, and essentially, the horizontal maps are Baum-Connes maps. The vertical arrows are induced by the bot. Induced by the bot and Dirac asymptotic morphisms. Now the right-hand side of this diagram is a little bit. So on the left, it's more or less defined. Now the right-hand side of the same diagram, it's slightly difficult to define. This one can be defined using the fact that you have essentially when you take C star the C star P. C star P reduced of G with coefficients in S is isomorphic to C star P reduced of G tends S. So this S and goes out, and one can use the Riemann integral thing to construct the approximation by Riemann sums to construct this this arrow. This arrow is most difficult to construct, but we need it only on the image of this map, of this Baum-Connes map, which is and there, you, if you remember, there is a, this subalgebra of L1 or compactly supported functions on G. It simplifies things. One can use it to define the this down arrow on the image of this map. And also, one can construct it, this arrow on the image of this blot map. So, in principle, the diagram not at the beginning is not completely defined, but it appears to be enough, because this arrow. Let me start with this. We can observe that this Baum-Connes map is actually an isomorphism. This requires some Meyer-Vilatoris type argument. So this essentially allows to define this Dirac element everywhere, because this map is surjective. We can prove that the compositions on the left and on the right, vertical maps, are identity by contracting the one cocycle to zero. So this is parallel to what is true in the Hilbert space case. And now the diagram allows to finish the argument in the same way as in Hilbert space case, because the injectivity of this arrow comes from the injectivity of the composition of this composition, and the surjectivity of this map. You take an element because this composition is identity. You take an element, you lift it here, then you it's actually lifted here, and then it comes from this group, just as usual argument for the L2 case. That's all I can say about this.
Thank you.